week's episode of Culture Diaries, we are here at Terra Culture in the heart of Victoria Island, a decade-old cultural centre which has been home to tons of plays and paintings from around Nigeria. Our guest today on the show is a painter, a sculptor, a writer, satirist. Sometimes we like to call him an interdisciplinary artist, or as I like to say, the brother, the hustle. Our guest on the show today is Victor Ehikhamenor. Welcome to the program. First question, why be an artist? Why be an artist in this kind of environment?
Well, thank you. It's something that I don't think I have control over. You know, like, it's almost like you have to breathe. So it doesn't matter where you are. If you're under the water, you have to figure out a way to surface and take that breath. That's how art is like for me.
You're also an interdisciplinary artist. Which of the art forms comes first, or which one? I mean, it's like asking you to choose one of your children. I know, but I'm going to do it anyway, because I actually forgot to mention you're also a photographer.
Yes.
So which of them comes closest for you, or what means the most?
I think it's drawing, because it started from that. That is kind of like the foundation of everything. Yeah. I started drawing on sands, slates, anything I could lay my hands on as early as, I would say 4 or 5, okay. You know, because I would say 4, because by the time I was 5, they had to give us slates to go to primary 1, you know, and I didn't want to do anything with that slate and chalk, you know, so I would draw on it. That was it. And, you know, it has always revolved around art. Anything I do has always revolved around art, you know, so. Yeah, it comes closest.
Let's talk about the now defunct Next newspaper, which, I mean, a lot of people knew you from that. A lot of us met through that medium as well. You were the creative director. You actually designed the cover. You actually designed the magazine, the newspaper and the magazines as well. Tell me a bit more about that, just creating that and bringing it together. What informed that for you?
Next, Timbuktu Media. Hired a consultant, Mario Garcia, to come and design the entire newspaper, you know, as a creative team and everything. So when he visited Nigeria, I was still in the U.S. when he came to Nigeria, you know, and Mario's style is that he would, you know, go around the city where the newspaper is going to be circulated or based on the feel of the city and the energy of the city. That is how he would design the color palette, design how the newspaper will look like. And he happened to visit Mukhtar Bakari's office, publisher of Farafina and Katifo, and he met one of my paintings there, and I was in Nigeria, so they told me, Alanti was quite elated, and he was like, oh, whose painting is this? He said, oh, it's Victor Ehikhamenor's own. So yeah, that's what I'm going to base my color palette of the entire newspaper on. So. When I visited in 2008, which was like June, you know, so I just finished my MFA. I needed a breather to come to Nigeria and just kind of have a feel and all that. And, you know, so I had this conversation with Mukhtar. I was like, oh, you know, we are starting this thing. This was what happened and all those. By now, you know, I was aware of what the newspaper was going to be doing and everything. So that was how he introduced me to Mario Garcia. Then we had a conversation and a drink, and he was like, I need you to come on board and be the creative director, because I'm like, I've never designed a newspaper before, so it would just be like another canvas for you, you know. So, and I'll teach you everything that you need to know, and, you know, so that was how I became his, I would say, apprentice. Mm-hmm. I just followed him, took notes and everything, and he would come and go. Like, he only had the few days to spend in Nigeria. You know, go through training sessions on designing the paper, the philosophy, the whole thing. I traveled to the U.S. and visited the creative department of Washington Post just to acquire the knowledge of myself and kind of mingle with them. And it worked.
You also work with a lot of creative people on that newspaper and project. Abraham Obase was a photographer. There's Adams, who was a cartoonist as well. Yeah. What was it like just being soaked in that kind of environment, especially as your foray back into Nigeria?
When I came back, I realized that there were, you know, I couldn't believe, because I left the country immediately I finished university. So I think I already worked 1 year in Nigeria. So it wasn't, I didn't really experience that whole Nigeria thing, you understand, corporate life and all those things. Yeah. When I came back and we're now hiring people in the creative department and we have to go through the whole process, I realized that there are people that just had that raw talent. It's just a matter of like, okay, why don't you do it like this? Why don't you, kind of like what a creative director is supposed to do, you write the script and watch them bring it to life. And, you know, that was how I found, you know, like, recruited Abraham and, of course, Adams. Adams just came to the office and was sketching things. I was just amazed as an artist, you know, so I was like, wow, you know, so, and so it wasn't like, oh, I bet to apply anything. If I see what you are doing, and we have a need for it and all that, infographics, art photography for Abraham, you understand, street photography for some of the guys that we got from other newspapers and all that, you know. So that was how that whole team of about 14 people, I think we were like 14 guys and one girl, which was Tai, who is an artist as well, Tai Daho, you know. So about 14 guys and it was a crazy day.
So you guys had your own sort of, you know how they had the Brit Pack going on, you had your own Nigerian Renaissance artist, contemporary crew going on. Let's go into your own work. Your work is very unique and very, very distinctive as well. And I think some people have described your paintings as ethnocentric, ethnographic, and there's all these interesting words that have been thrown about. But if you've not seen Victor's work or his paintings, it's very much characterized by the etchings or the labyrinths, very, very massive scale labyrinths. Tell me about how that came into being for you. How did you find that? How did that style come into being?
I would say probably those are inborn, because it's later on in life that I realized that I was talking a lot of those while I was in the village. I grew up in the village, and the friends had these symbols and signs, and in my own case, those that were doing it that could tell me what it was are no longer alive, but they are still there, you understand? These signs and symbols and all that are still there that I soaked in as a kid. So the more I travel, the more I now go back to my inner self to remember those things, I began to realize them. It's like teaching kids ABC, and you know, whatever you now, from ABC, you now form sentences, from sentences, you now form, if you're a writer, you know, you can't tell me that you can be a writer without having that foundation of having ABC. So my own ABC was growing up in the village and watch women paint their walls, draw their walls and everything. So eventually I started employing that into my paintings and all that, and to create my own visual language.
I've been for quite a lot of your exhibitions. I want to go into, so with something that is a recurring theme within a couple of them, so I would say from something like Entrances and Exits to African Time, is this juxtaposition of past and present and past and future, and it's like you're also constantly trying to make a statement. Is this a conscious thing? Is it a theme that just is recurring in your life? Because there is this bridge between the past and modernity, that clash that goes on. I actually have a couple of your paintings that also speak that as well. So I want you to just elaborate a bit more.
I'm glad you put it that way. I deal a lot with memory and nostalgia. You know, otherwise, I wouldn't have felt comfortable coming back to Nigeria. You know, I would say I was very comfortable in America, but comfortable physically, but I wasn't psychologically. So I keep referring to my past, not the bad past, but because I had a fantastic childhood, you know, so a very colorful childhood, grew up in a very lovely environment, in a loving home and everything. So I keep wanting to recreate that, and I wanted to go back to that and say, look, we can benefit from it. There are things that we are throwing away. We are throwing away a whole lot of things that are necessary for us to move forward, you understand? Not necessarily letting the past weigh us down, but what can you learn? What can you say? Okay, you went to university like a surgeon, and you are you are having a heart operation in the theater, and you forgot something. Your professor in your 6 years or whatever, how many years you spent in medical school, would have told you something that you can reference quickly within that few seconds, and that would save your life. So as an artist, I like that. I like the ability to be able to bring that past and situate it in the present.
I was also at your exhibition in London, Chronicles of an Enchanted World. I think my two favorite and standout pieces, Lovers of Good Evening Streets and Come Home to Happiness. and of course, Struggle for Big Mama's Fru. Even before Chronicles of an Enchanted World, just going back even to your other work, women play a very huge role in your work. What is it? What's the fascination or the obsession with women? I mean, I know we are beautiful and we are complex and all these things, but what
is it? That is it. You are right for me because, you know, first of all, my mom has a very strong difference on the way I grew up. My father was more like the philosophical type that would just like tell you, like use words that just go into you like capsule and they explode inside you as a kid, you understand, you know. So that was his style. He never used strong language or anything, just that philosophical. When people say, oh, you have so much proverbs, you use a lot of aphorisms and everything, that is just naturally from my dad. Yeah. But that whole strong, I mean, the kid to make sure that you mold the child. It's like I was wet clay in my mom's hands, and mm-hmm. she was the one that really molded that thing. Like, okay, don't touch that, don't speak to this, don't do that, don't, you understand? Kind of like that daily thing, you know. So I have a great respect for that, you know. And my dad also raised us to respect women a lot. Mm-hmm. You understand, you know. So It's an ode to the woman when I keep referencing to her. And of course, they are the most beautifully made, you know, so, and like the Bible says, beautifully and fearfully made, you know, so I like that. But every artist you would see, historically, they always have that reference, you know, women are muse, are the muse of artists and all those things. Look at Picasso, how many of, you know, series of women that he painted and all those things. It's not about promiscuity or anything.
You just love women.
Yes.
Let's put it that way. All this big grammar I just love women. Yeah,
you're very restless. You seem very restless. You're constantly challenging yourself and looking for newer things. So even within your painting, you involve a bit of sculpture. Sometimes there's installation in there as well. You're always trying to sort of, do you deliberately try to push boundaries or push the mold, or is this just something that you're doing without knowing?
I would say I've become part of it, but I just hate boredom. You know, I just hate the fact that, you know, you come, it's like you eat pandogram in the morning as much as you like it. In the afternoon, you eat pandogram. In the evening, you eat pandogram. You know, so, you know, I mean, it's you know, don't disrespect your audience. Yeah. Don't take your audience or your collectors for granted, you understand? You know, so for me, it's also, first of all, for me, I have to do something that interests me first, yeah. You understand? Remember that we did an installation piece together where I first of all, like, look at the wall and used chalks and everything, and you were part of that. And from there, I can tell you that was the beginning of me moving that to a bigger canvas, because people were saying, oh, how come they can't just collect this wall? They can't understand that it was just to air out something or a foundation for something. And yeah. There were so many questions. Okay, how come you are doing something that we cannot collect?
Yeah, so it's experiential art.
It was experiential art for me. Yeah. You know, it was just to, like, you know, pour it out there and everything. And from there, I moved on to putting them on large canvases. It opened up my mind that, look, you can't tell, like, prime a canvas as big as the wall that you and Wana has worked on, yeah. And it become... They become collectible, you understand? So that was how that whole series of very large 13-foot canvas that you saw in London and all those things, almost like moving from short story to now writing novels, an entire novel on the canvas, you understand? So you can see restlessness and everything. And I've come back to that again by, we did one war in 2011. In 2016, the first project that I just did now is to convert an entire war and just play it out.
You recently did a little detour or a foray into the world of fashion, where you collaborated with the designer Itembasi.
Yeah.
So you've almost become a fabric designer as well in this process. So tell me about how that came into fruition, and what the feedback has been like.
Well, first of all, the feedback has been phenomenal. I would say when I first saw Itembasi's works in 2009, after I'd moved back, I fell in love with her colors.
Okay.
Like, they were really beautiful, and what she was doing with fabrics was almost like what a painter would do with brush and paint.
Absolutely.
So It was kind of natural. It was just a matter of time for me to, like I say, I carry my ideas. I just filed it away somewhere, like, okay, one day. So I had a show at Temple Muse, and Itwin Basi also had some of our designs stuck there, you know. So, and the former editor of Elan, Kemi Ogunleye, who is a common friend between us, came to see my exhibition, and while she was going around, and she just saw Itwin's works, and you know, for a creative person, that would speak to her, and she was like, whoa, something is going on here. So she picked up the phone, was like, you know, I went to Temple Muse, and I think you and Itwin should do something together. Mm. I was like, wow, I've been thinking about it. I mean, for almost, what now, almost 5 years that I've been carrying that idea. It's amazing that you kind of like, hinted on it and everything, and I said, I don't have a problem with Itwin. I mean, she's somebody that I respect her work a lot, very creative and everything. Okay, let me call Itwin. And she called Itwin. Itwin was so excited because Itwin is also very familiar with my works and everything. And so it was just kind of like a marriage made in Lagos. What I did was give her the designs and just hands off because I know that I could trust her with my eyes closed. Yeah. And I was waiting to see what she would do with them, and fabulous things that she did with them. So I'm happy with the outcome of it, as well as a whole lot of people around the world, you know, up to New York and all that, you know, people are collecting it around the world, you know. So
people are experiencing Victor Ehikhamenor not just as a visual artist, but as a wearable form of art as well.
I think you can put it like that. There has to be something for everybody, you know. So, you know, there are people that don't like art, you know, but they will like
Speaking about that, it's also about almost like diversifying your product as well.
Yeah, but very carefully.
Okay.
But very carefully. Mm. I mean, you know, I don't want to out you out there, but you know that you're my collector.
Yeah.
And you don't want to go out there and not see your what you are collecting, and to be almost like, it's not like elitist thing, but you want what you have bought to be kind of like respected, you understand, you know, so based on what you have probably paid for it or something like that. So it's not everything that you see it on, but what you have seen it on is very respectable and is seen in a great light, you know. So I'm very particular about that.
When it comes to arts, everyone is called, especially visual arts, People are saying, this is, you know, rich man's territory.
Yeah.
People, the thought that comes to mind is very wealthy people walking through gallery spaces, sipping on champagne and eating canapes and all of that. And but the truth is that we're also assaulted by art on a daily basis, whether it's in architecture, greenery around you, to performance. Lagos is light theatre.
Yes.
So how do you think we can sort of marry those worlds together and sort of break this bridge and this gap, so to speak?
Well, that conversation will always be there, that art is only for the elitist, and only art can only be found in VI and all those things, which is not true. I found art in the village, in my own village. So it's just a matter of for you to look. You know, it's what you are fine-tuned to that you will look. If you want to see art, the poorest person, if they want to encounter art, they don't bring that conversation. People that bring that conversation are the people that are not really cultured. You understand what I'm saying? People, it's not, multimillionaires are not the best collectors. Go and look at people like Vogel. There's this couple in the US that had one of their, I think the man is late now, you understand? He was a post office worker when he started collecting works. So it's your appreciation for it first, if you like it and all those things. So bringing it back to, okay, how can we put art to the people and all those things, it goes back to how much of it do we feature even in our newspapers? How much art do we feature? How much of art do we open our people's eyes to? You go to all these places, you see walls being drawn on, you have graffiti all over Lagos and everything and all that. As an artist, I don't go past them without looking at them.
Yeah.
You understand? So even if I go to, I don't know what is, I don't want to mention names in Lagos and say, okay, this is a low-income place and all those things. But you go to some places and all those things, they are all there. Social media has also liberalized that. I use that a lot to like share my works with people that are following. You don't necessarily have to collect the work. Appreciation is more appreciated by an artist. Let's put it that way. You know, when you appreciate a piece of work of an artist, you know, it's better than, it feels more fulfilled than, you know, somebody that doesn't even appreciate it and putting millions in it. The more you put it out there, the more you let people know, because you don't know who is following you that is trying to say, okay, what do I do with my talent?
Yeah.
What do I do with my life?
Yeah.
What do I do with the words that I have? By doing that, I'm hoping that somebody is, you know, I will speak to somebody and say, oh, wow, this can be done. You know, oh, I would love to do this. You understand? You know, so you have to be able to use that to change a certain generation. You understand? You know, so because that upcoming generation don't have time for probably the physical things and all that, you know, so how do you meet them? I think we leave that in our educational, you know, leave that in our educational places whereby we are not constantly upgrading how people are learning, how kids are learning, and all that. We still want to do things in the physical way and all those things. Meanwhile, things have moved past that, you know. So I want to make sure that, you know, whatever is trending, I must be able to engage my generation. So I'm engaging a generation that I belong to and even probably a younger generation.
Which piece of work or which work of art do you wish you made?
I don't remember the name now, but it's by... Oh, no, I do remember. It's a work by Yusuf Grillo.
Okay.
It's called The Medicant.
Hmm.
I don't know who owns it. It's just like really this... I encountered it in the U.S. In the 90s, late 90s, in the book, and it really spoke to me. It was kind of like, I guess I was missing Lagos. It was just this beggar putting his head on the person leading him, you know, and it was just this hue of his blue and indigo and purple and a little bit of red mixed together, you know. So I really loved it, and you know, I made it for myself, you know, so I will not sell it, you know, it's in my house in the States, you know, so I will never sell it, you know, so I made it for myself, and I said an ode to Yusuf Grillo, you know.
All
so,
right.
Yeah.
Who would you like to paint naked?
Wana Udobang.
Favorite living artist?
Ooh, too many to mention. Too many.
Favorite non-living artist?
I like Keith Haring. I mean, I know he's not Nigerian or anything, but I like what he was doing with his lines as well. Just that kind of duatone, you know, what he did with his works, you know. So.
Favorite color and why?
I love red. I mean, like, I'm from Edo State. Our soil is very red. So, and it's also...
The proper kind of the soil.
Yes, exactly. So, and it's one of those colors that I gravitate towards. Like, Tony Khan will say, hey, Victor has not used red on the painting. He has not painted it yet, you know. So, yeah, I love red. I just naturally gravitate towards that.
What sound do you love painting to?
Silent. No. Benin music.
Okay.
Benin music.
When was the last time you cried and why?
I don't remember, but I'm an emotional artist. I can cry to a film, and I don't watch movies that have kids tormented or anything. I don't watch them at all.
Okay.
I can't handle it.
Oh,
so,
wow.
Yeah.
Best advice you've ever been given?
By my dad.
What was it?
Your hand will always feed you.
What song will be the soundtrack to your life?
Has to be an Asian song, traditional song.
Man.
I don't joke with it. I don't wear it lightly.
What if you were a fruit, what would you be and why?
I'll say orange. My father had an orange farm. And we used to go there and just chill and pluck fresh orange and eat and sweet. So we could tell.
I'm seeing this palette of reds, oranges, mustard, yellow.
I love bright. You know, I mean, I do black and whites,
more,
but I do love bright colors.
Yeah, you are known for your very colorful words when you write.
I try.
Do you think art can change the world and why?
Yeah, but it might not be the kind of change people are looking for that dramatic all of a sudden make a man a woman or something like that or stop the war and all those things.
Yeah.
But it's something that we provide a kind of succor for you. You understand? That kind of change, you understand? Like the world is burning and you can quickly like hide under art and all that, you know? So, I mean, look at what we are doing here now is because this place is an art place. You understand? That's why we can come and have that conversation. Is that a change? Of course, yes. We don't have a museum that you can go to and do this if you wanted to. So can art change? Yes, art has in that way changed that situation that would have been useless in Lagos. And an art space like this has reversed that. So when you look at it like that, you have to take them in bits and pieces, because if you're looking at a massive thing, that's when people get discouraged, get confused that, oh, this thing did not just change, you understand? You know. So we have to take change in small bits and bites.
Thank you so much for being thank you on very Culture
much.
Diaries.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for watching. Hope you guys enjoyed that conversation. If you'd like to find out all the weird and wonderful things I get up to, feel free to follow me on my social media channels. And don't forget to check out my website to find out all the happenings in the world of art and culture. Until next time, remember, art is